Everybody ready?
Ready?
Yeah.
All right, listen.
It's your weekend show.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
With Bob Biermann.
It's great.
And welcome to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. I'm so glad you're taking some time from your busy weekend schedule to spend it with me. This is a very special weekend for me personally on a number of levels. And as you know, we talk about life and the experience that we go through, each and every one of us. We all have our times of joy, our time of sadness, our time of gain, our time of loss, our time of happiness, our times of sadness, our time, the time that we experience family love, and the time we lose a loved one. We've talked about that so many times over these past almost 4 years now. Since the very beginning of this program in March of 2015. What makes this weekend special are some of the memories. You know, last week we talked about several things, and over the past 2 weeks in particular. In the last few weeks here, what we've talked about, I shared losing a brother-in-law about a month ago and attending a funeral and seeing some family and friends that I hadn't seen in too many years, and I had to ask myself the question that very night. Why is it we get so caught up in our own lives that some people that meant so much for us, have faded away because we get so busy? And then I had to think to myself, you know, just sharing that, you know, how much I miss the contact, and because my first wife had died is primarily the reason that a lot of that contact over time began to fade away. After she died, I didn't have as much contact with her sister, her brother, my sister-in-law and brother-in-law at the time. And it's amazing how you call about once every couple of weeks and every couple of months, and then before you know it, it's a year. And then you don't realize it, but you've lost touch. And it's a very sad thing, and we, in this day and age, we are so bombarded with information and social media and connections, sometimes we lose the connection to the things that are most important. And I know that I've been somewhat guilty of that. It happened to me. And I want to talk about that a little bit on the program today. Right after we had that program, talking about that loss, I shared a program from 2015 that I recorded that kind of shared some musical memories and going back in time. We live in a day and age today. My wife and I were talking about it just this morning, in fact, that we have this anger and angst, especially in the United States and the Western world, the likes of which we've never seen. And it's almost like there are forces that are trying to divide us against each other, which never used to happen like it does today. Politics used to be a contact sport. Now it's a blood sport. And it's too sad. You know, I will say this much, that my appreciation for politicians of any party has been highly diminished over the last 15, 20 years. There are principles that I stand for and no longer party. They have lost me because those that claim to be of a party and never behave that way, and others that seem to want to divide us against each other. I have lost all faith in political parties, but then again, the Bible even warns us, you know, don't put your hopes in kings and horses. There's one you can't put your hope in. But like I say, a couple of weeks ago, we shared a program of musical memories taking us back in time, and then last week we acknowledge the beginning of the season of Advent, the countdown to Christmas. But I ended the program not even realizing or thinking of the dates and everything involved, talking about the hope we have in the resurrection for those that we have lost. Now, it's a hard balance, and those that have been where I'm at will understand this 100%. I was married for 29 years to a wonderful woman, and I lost her to cancer in 2004. And there's still a part of her that lives in my heart, and always will. You keep them alive. My wife now also lost her husband in 2014, so she's a widow. I'm a widower. We've found such happiness and blessings in our relationship. But it doesn't negate those that were so much a part of our lives for so many years. And I didn't realize as I ended the program last week the significance of this particular song that I'm about to play again as we open our program today. By the way, this is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Biermann. You can always find us at yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com on the internet, even on Facebook at Your Weekend Show. Look for Your Weekend Show, all one word. Like I say, I ended last week's program not even realizing that I was kind of setting up this weekend's particular program. And I debated, do I want to go in this direction or not? But as we are getting closer to Christmas, it's a hard time. It's going to be a hard time for a lot of people. And rather than wait until the last minute, maybe it's time we address that for some people. And it's going to happen to all of us. All of us one day are going to have a sad Christmas because someone you love, maybe a sibling, maybe a parent, maybe a spouse, whatever the case may be, and yes, even at times a child, won't be there this Christmas. And it's hard for many. But you know, if we have faith and we have hope, we will see them again.
Always, you will be part of me, and I will forever feel your strength when I need it more. You're gone now, gone but not forgotten. I can't say this to your face, but I know you hear. I'll see you again. You never really left. I feel you walk beside.
beautiful song from Westlife. And I'll see you again. You're listening to your weekend show. I'm your host, Bob Biermann. We're heard on international shortwave, domestic radio, and even online. You can find us at yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com. You can even find us on Facebook at Your Weekend Show. Just type in Your Weekend Show. If you make it one word, you find us right away on Facebook. We would love to hear from you this week. It's hard to believe that it's only, what, 2 weeks and a few days until we arrive at Christmas Day. And I was thinking to myself, as that song was playing, the many Christmases that I've been through in my life. Like I say, a couple of weeks ago, we kind of focused on that point in our lives as we're finishing high school, starting college, beginning our families, and how it impacts our life. The little things we do that oftentimes we take for granted and don't even think about, that can affect the trajectory of our lives entirely. I've shared with you before little decisions about career, where to go to school, that chance first date, getting the courage to ask somebody out can change your life forever. I know on a couple of occasions it has thoroughly changed mine. We're talking about those that we love today for just a while on the program here, at least at the beginning part, as we're getting close to Christmas. And I know for a lot of people, it can be a very, very difficult time of the year. It's supposed to be a time of family and good times, but there are people, this may be their first year without their spouse, without their parent or grandparent. And Christmas for them is going to be vastly different than Christmas was before. It's always different. I've been there. I was thinking about my childhood Christmases the other day. And as we got right after Thanksgiving, we didn't put our tree up weeks before Thanksgiving to put it up there with Halloween stuff. We waited till after Thanksgiving. Actually, in our family, more like the third Sunday in Advent, when you only have about a week before Christmas, did our tree even go up. And I can remember looking at the Sears wish book. I can remember what it was like on a Christmas morning to get up, to come down the stairs and see the tree and the gifts. I can remember then going to my grandparents' house and spending time there. My grandparents, my parents, they're long gone. These are just memories that are part of your life. I remember starting out as a young man, being a newlywed, and that first Christmas under a very scrawny live tree with the most basic of decorations. And there's a picture that I cherish to this day of my late wife and I. Someone took in the living room. I'm laying on the floor. I'm still dressed up from coming home from work wearing a tie. And there are gifts around. There are gifts around the tree. We're beginning to get ready for Christmas. I remember that first Christmas without her. I was still the pastor of a church, and it was so hard. Oh, you just don't know how hard it was. I lost her in the end of September. Her final funeral, because we had two, one in her hometown and one where we were living at the time. Those couple of months were terrible. And then that Christmas Eve service. The Christmas Eve service, I missed her so much. But even then, as I conducted that worship service late at night by candlelight, you know, I could feel that part of her that was a part of me. Maybe theologically it's questionable, but I could feel that presence, and I knew that she knew that I was all right that Christmas Eve.
Who can say for certain? Maybe you're still here. I feel you all around me.
your memory so clear. Deep in the stillness, I can hear you speak. You're still an inspiration. Can it be that you are mine forever, love? And you are watching over me from up above. Fly me up to where you are beyond the distant stars. Cherish all you gave me every day.
Song by Josh Groban here on your weekend show. Here we are in the second weekend of December, only a little over 2 weeks away from Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. And I thought here at the first part of the program we would talk about what it is to celebrate Christmas, especially when you've suffered a loss in your life. I know for some of you listening to this program today, this may be the first Christmas coming where you're celebrating without somebody that meant the world to you, whether it's a grandparent, a parent, a sibling, spouse, and yes, in some cases, maybe even the loss of a child. And you wonder how you're going to make it through this time of the year. And I've been there. I know a lot of you have, too, that are listening. I've been there. It's not easy, that first Christmas. You so desperately want to have them back. You so desperately miss them that first year. There's no doubt in my mind. But you know, there's a hope that Christmas brings us that I think that we've lost sight of in this world that we live in today. When you think about it, in the Western world, we live a lot longer a lot longer than we used to live. You go back to the 1800s, 1700s, 1500s, and, you know, go back 1,000 years. Today, it's common for people to live in their 60s and 70s and well into their 80s. It's not that unusual. Oftentimes, outside of an accident or some disease that cannot be treated in time or incurable, people tend to live longer than we ever did. People married at a much younger age generations ago. It was not uncommon here in the United States 50 years ago, 100 years ago, for girls as young as 15 or 16 to get married to a guy that's 17 or 18. It was not uncommon at all. And the reason it really wasn't all that uncommon was when the laws were written, oftentimes men didn't live much into their 40s before they passed away, and the women lived to around 50. Enough time to raise their children and maybe see their first grandchildren. Living to be 65, 75, or 85 was a rarity just 100 years ago. We've come a long way. We live a long time. Of course, many of our expectations have changed in these past 100 years. I look at my life, the things that have changed in just my lifetime. The things that I thought would be secure and never changing have changed. The career I thought I would have didn't turn out the way I envisioned. You know, in many ways, we have so many of the things today that we had when I was growing up. You know, I was born in the 50s, and that was the beginning of the jet age. And so I remember the transition from propeller aircraft for airlines to jet aircraft. Jet aircraft have been pretty much the staple for much of our air traffic commercially since the 1960s. I can remember flying on Eastern Airlines in 1966 on a jet to an airport that still exists in South Carolina. I traveled extensively in the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s by air. And overall, it really wasn't that different of an experience, at least as a traveler. The only thing noticeable was their new technologies, and they crammed more people into that aircraft than they ever did before. I think the biggest change in air travel is the dress code. You know, back in the 60s, women dressed up and men wore suits and ties. And now today, it looks like they wear their pajamas when they fly. People don't seem to care as much as they used to. Instead of handing our luggage over, as we most often did, now we try to cram it into the overhead bin because we don't want to pay the $25 a bag fee. And I can understand that. We have gradually changed a lot of things in these past 50 or 60 years. Let's use the 60 or 50 year point, like 1958 or 1968, to see where we've come. You know, we've always, as I said at the earlier part of the program today, we've always dealt with politics, but not like we see today. And maybe it's just the amplification of instantaneous social media that has changed the landscape more than any one thing. I know I'm getting a little off topic here, but it does have a lot to do with our mental attitude about holidays and family and the things that are important. You know, 50 years ago, you had the evening news and maybe a couple of minute newscast on the hour from a radio station, and you had your daily newspapers. There was no such thing as the 24/7 news cycle and news analysis programs that we have today. Now, I'm not saying they're a good thing or a bad thing. They're just a thing. And if we spend too much time worrying about the news cycle, I think it takes a toll on our humanness and our compassion. We begin to lose sight. We begin to look at life through political lenses and not human lenses. And maybe that's the greatest destruction of the information and internet age. We have so many good things from this technology, computers in general, and even the internet. But there's some bad that seems to come along with all the good, especially in this electronic world that we live in today. And so many people strive to have more of today than we did a generation ago. You know, I've been tracking technology for quite a long time. It was so much a part of my life in my work. So in the 1980s, I'm already beginning to understand where computers are and the things they may someday be able to do, especially if we can get more storage or more speed or more random access memory, which we inevitably did. In 1985, I could already see the power of what will be the personal computer. I had one at home, and I began to understand what it could do in industry and business, replacing so many of the ways we did things prior in a more efficient manner. And then in the 1990s, people began to discover the personal computer and dial-up internet, and we first got our peak at looking for things online. And within, 20 years, the idea of the yellow pages and an encyclopedia in our homes, you know, I don't have a yellow pages in my house. I no longer have an encyclopedia of any kind. There's no need for it because by the time they get one printed, it's already out of date. We become very dependent upon the internet for our information, and there lies another problem we face in this day and age. Trusting the source of that information. There is so much stuff out there in the internet that is absolute and utter nonsense and foolishness and out and out lies that people will read and believe and forward. The internet is convenient, but it also has made us lazy. We just assume if we see something we agree with, it's got to be true, and we forward it along, and more times than not, I'm finding lately, it's not true, or it's exaggerated, or it's incomplete. We now have a generation of young people that are using these electronic devices. You know, my wife, my late wife, died in 2004. And in 2004, we both had cell phones, but they were definitely not smartphones. They were little flip phones to keep us in touch with each other, to make telephone calls. I didn't even text. I didn't see any value in it at the time. Besides, you know, you're typing on a numerical board. You got to hit the one, number two button three times to get the letter C. And it just seemed too klutzy and too labor-intensive to send some limited character text when in less time I could dial the number and say, hey, what do you need from the store? In 2004, my wife and I, we both had pretty powerful for their day and age personal computers running on Windows XP. We even had a home network, which a lot of people didn't. We had our two computers connected in our office, and we had one of the first Wi-Fi connections where I lived at the time, so I could connect my daughter who lived right next door. So she, on a limited budget, didn't have to worry about paying for internet. We were ahead of our time. but never would I believe the speed of growth of the internet, web pages, and the things that were to come. In 2004, we never heard about Facebook. It was something new. Twitter, Instagram, none of those things were even on the horizon, at least for most people, not me. And I thought that we had risen to a point, honestly, in technology. I knew certain things were going to change and grow. And I'm wondering, do we need faster computers? Do we need to make anything smaller for our everyday use? And I never expected to see the changes in technology that I did over the next 10 years. It was a race that by 2014, the internet became such a part of our life. I realized by 2014, I'd had a smartphone now for almost 5 years. A good one. You know, when the iPhone came along, it changed the landscape, followed by the Android operating system and those first telephones. And look at where we are today. It is good that we have all this power at our fingertips. I think of some of the good things that this technology does. It keeps me in touch with our two houses to make sure things are okay. With a cellular backup and the regular internet, I can check the thermostat at the house. I can know if anybody's tried to break in. I can even look at cameras to see what's going on at either location. And that's a good part of the technology. If I need information or directions because I'm trying to get somewhere, between GPS and our cell phones, we can virtually find anything. If I'm new to a community and I'm looking for a specific kind of store because I need something, like where's the nearest, you know, drugstore? Where's the nearest grocery store? Whatever the case may be, where's the nearest health center if you had an injury? Instead of trying to find the yellow pages on a map, you can simply go to your phone and in seconds, there's your options. So in that regard, technology has been a positive thing. And so as I look back over time, we started talking about the memories of where we were and where we've come in just the last 10 to 14, 15 years, the incredible changes that I've seen in my life. 1972, graduating high school. I was thinking then, what kind of education do I need and what are my job options for a career? And as I've shared dozens of times on this program, I have these aspirations of doing basically two things. I was going to be both an engineer and a disc jockey. I was going to enjoy riding that wave of top 40 music on AM radio and always have the engineering side locked up so I would have a backup. You know, when I started out as a radio announcer, AM was the big dominant voice. FM, it was hard to give commercial time away for free on an FM station back in 1972. And I envisioned myself, you know, working my way up the ladder and having that special Federal Communications Commission license, not just to be an operator, but to be a technician, would be valuable, because especially if you were trying to work your way up to bigger stations, some of those nighttime radio stations were directional, and you needed to have that special license to be the combo operator at night. And you could get a job at a 5 or 10,000 watt directional station in a bigger city if you had that, which is your gateway to get into a bigger city like a Cleveland or a Chicago, a Detroit, a Fort Wayne, Indiana, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, maybe even someday a New York City. And that was my goal in 1972. But the world changed in a short order. when I married my late wife in 1975, you know, I'm still thinking that this is going to be my pattern in life. I'm doing the technical thing. I'm on the air. I'm working my way up the food chain. My interim goal at that point was to get from a small town in Georgia to a bigger town in Georgia than Atlanta, and then go from there. But the world changed in just a matter of years, and FM became dominant. Engineers, well, the FCC changed the rules, and having that license wasn't quite as important anymore than having the skill. And then proving that skill set was your next obstacle. But I adapted in the 80s, and again in the 90s, and then again in the year 2000. And I realized by the time that I was at the year 2000, my life had changed extraordinarily. Besides, along the way, there was a call that I felt in my heart that just tugged at me to make a career addition or career change, whichever you want to call it. I never quite gave up the broadcast. But I felt a call to ministry in the 1990s, and my late wife supported me 100%. Knowing the sacrifices that would be made, knowing the difficulty of getting an education, knowing all we would have to go through for a number of years and give up our comfortable lifestyle at the time, and she said yes, and we went forward, and I added that to what I do. I can honestly tell you I've never gotten wealthy from ministry. It never happened. But I've had some wonderful blessings and wonderful times in that work, and still do. She supported me, and we moved to Florida as a result of that, and she loved it there, I loved it there, and then I lost her there. Life is full of change. You know, those decisions of who you date, who you ask out, make a big difference. It was in February of 19, maybe it was March, end of February, beginning of March, can't exactly remember the date, I know it was still cold, when I first met my first wife, who was working at a drugstore in a small town in Georgia. And she was very pretty and caught my eye. And I decided to, well, pursue this if I could, and I kept coming back to that drugstore. They had a luncheonette counter. And finally got the courage to ask her out after I determined, you know, she was available. Had I never asked her out, had I gone to a different place to eat lunch, my life would have been dramatically different. A person I asked out in high school, and it took a lot of courage for me to do it back then. I was kind of shy. And she said yes, and she changed my life incredibly. That's why I went to Ohio instead of Chicago to get my education or other places that were being recommended. Because she had left the town we were living in, and her family had moved to Ohio. Once again, all these little things you do in life can have a dramatic change on what you do. And then you find your life, as you get to my age, is a sequence of dates, memories, and events that you look back on. Some hurt. Some you try to forget, and others give you the most warm feeling of joy and contentment in your heart. The memories like that first date, the day you propose and she said yes, the day you get married, get your first house, buy together your first car, whatever the case may be, the things that you do starting out. Tending to the business of a family. The holidays you celebrate, the traditions you blend from both your families. And for years you build upon those things. And over time you lose parents, you lose grandparents, other friends. But you have each other, and then one day, one or the other is gone. and you have to decide, do you keep living or do you start over again? Starting all over again is not easy. I know. And oftentimes, as I did, you can make some serious mistakes. And it takes a while to recoup from them as well. But you know, as I look at my life today, and I hope you can look at yours, and realize while not everything went the way you wanted it to, I hope you can say that there's a life full of some good memories out there. That you created some real times in your life. One of the things that I like about this upcoming Christmas season, to me, it has a twofold purpose. Number one, of course, it is remembering that Jesus Christ came into the world to redeem the world for himself and to restore us to our Heavenly Father by his life ministry on this earth, his death and his resurrection. But it also can be a time to stop, pause, and find the importance of family and friends. Unfortunately, as many of us know, we get into the Christmas or holiday spirit, whatever you call it. Hallmark Channel is playing all those wonderful, heart-wrenching movies. The Christmas specials, the music blaring on the radio and on speakers in big box stores. And for a few moments, we get this warm feeling about peace on earth and goodwill toward men. But by the time we get to the first of the year, it seems that all the peace on earth and goodwill is forgotten, and we get right back to where we were. It's like a brief respite. You know, during the First World War, the story is told about the Germans fighting out there in the trenches in France. And it seemed that that war was nothing more than lobbing bombs, firing bullets and poison gas at each other. And by Christmas, troops are weary, and they pause for a brief time and even celebrated Christmas together until they were ordered back to start killing each other again. That's a condition of man. You know, emotion is fine. It's something that it's a part of who we are and what we do. But let me tell you something. Emotion can be fleeting. It's grasping on to things that are bigger and more long-lasting than just simply a fleeting emotion. We experience emotions, but we make memories. What are your memories today? What are the times that you're thinking about? This is your weekend show, and I'm your host, Bob Biermann. I want to remind you again that you can find us at the website, yourweekendshow.com. Yourweekendshow.com. Also, you can find us on Facebook at Your Weekend Show. I've been just sharing from the heart this segment, the things that are on my heart and my mind as we get closer to Christmas. And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking of the times in my life.
Good morning, yesterday. You wake up and time has slipped away. And suddenly it's hard to find the memories you left behind. Remember, do you remember? Tears, the shadows of misty yesteryears, the good times and the bad you've seen, and all the others in between. Remember, do you remember the times of your life?
while you may collect the dreams you dream today. Remember, will you remember the times of your life? While you may collect the dreams you dream today, remember, will you remember the times of your life? Of your life, of your life. Do you remember, baby? Do you remember the times of your life?
Paul Anka and the times of your life. Here on your weekend show, I'm your host, Bob Biermann. Want to remind you very quickly, don't forget our website to find out more about the program. It is yourweekendshow.com, yourweekendshow.com. Facebook also, just simply look for Your Weekend Show. I remember when that song, The Times of Your Life, came out as a single by Paul Anka. Paul Anka had been a big star in the earlier part of the 1960s, and he had a bit of a comeback in the 1970s, and that particular song became one of the most popular songs of 1975, and I remember it very well. It's the year that I got married. And I liked the song. I played it because, remember, I was a disc jockey back in those days. And I halfway to this day remember the words. But as I listen to the song now, it has so much more significance to me today than it did 40-plus years ago. 43 years ago. Hard to believe that that song has been around that long. And in those 43 years since the song was released and I first played it and listened to it, how those words have taken on this incredible meaning in my life. Life is a sequence of memories and events. They become the times of your life. It's the sum of the things you've done. There's so many people, sadly, that live in the moment that never understand what it truly means to make a memory. They're so busy living in the moment, they can't remember what they've done and what they've experienced. And come the end of the day, what do they have to show for their life? Broken relationships, often. Nothing of stability, often. You know, I think back now, as we're doing this radio program and have done on many shows, when I think back over time, I feel very blessed that I did have the opportunity to create memories and times in my life from my childhood into my teens, my 20s, 30s, 40s, and even into my 50s, and still making wonderful memories with this wonderful woman that has become my wife, Lori. That we have this great life together. It's a place that if you had asked me 10 years ago, would I be where I'm at today? I would have looked at you cross-eyed and I wouldn't have understood. If you had asked me in 1975, I wouldn't even have anything to base it on. I hadn't had the experience of life. But I can truly say that I've had some wonderful times in my life. Oh yeah, there have been the bad times too. That's kind of what this program has been about a little bit today. Even the bad times too. Here we are, 2 weeks and a few days away from Christmas. And though the stores want to make you think we're already there, it's still a season of Advent, of preparation. And I want to, before the program gets away today, to remind ourselves of why there's a Christmas and why we need to be prepared, not just to remember Christmas Day or that time when Jesus came to earth to live among men, but to be in this perpetual Advent of his second coming. And mark my words, I am convinced beyond any reasonable shadow of a doubt that he is coming again to redeem his own.
Hark a thrilling voice is sounding. Christ is near, we hear the cry. Cast away the works of darkness, all you children of the day. Startled at the song of warning, let the earthbound soul arise. Christ its on all sloth dispelling shines upon the morning skies. See the Lamb so long expected comes with pardon down from heaven. Let us haste with tears of sorrow, one and all to be forgiven.
Today's program has been, well, kind of an eclectic mix of thoughts and feelings and music and emotion. And in its own way, it was designed to be specifically that way. I started the program just sharing from my heart some of the events in my life that bring me to where I am today. And I hope that as you listened, if you listened to the entire program, that maybe you were thinking about those special times in your life. We shared about what it's like to lose a loved one, whether it's a grandparent, parent, spouse, and yeah, even a child. And the difficulties that places on us at this time of the year for many as we are approaching Christmas and New Year. It's coming up faster than we think. And I tell myself, where is 2018 gone? Seems like only yesterday, celebrating Christmas 2017. And now a whole year has just run by. I remember my grandparents and my parents all telling me that as you get older, time goes by faster. And they are so right. I guess when I was a child and you begin school in September, back in our day it was September, and you think of Christmas, oh, it's 3 months away. How am I going to ever get to Christmas? It's like forever. And now, where did September and October and November go? I know for me, these past weeks have flown by in all that my wife and I are doing. And we'll be back in Florida. We are in Florida now, spending time until the spring. And there's so much to do there, and that time in Florida is going to race by. Seems that life flies by. But as I'm doing the program today, I think of the sadness and the joy that I've been through in this life. I've been fortunate enough to experience both and to overcome the grief that can come into our lives. I've also seen the hand of God, how He can restore us if we're obedient and listen and don't just react and jump. This has been an interesting program today. I think I've covered a few more bases than I anticipated, and I did not want to lose sight of this second Sunday in Advent, this second weekend. And I hope that we take time to focus on the things that are important and maybe, just maybe, find that place in our hearts to yield and find what true happiness in our Savior Jesus Christ is all about. Don't forget the website, yourweekendshow.com. That is yourweekendshow.com. Also, you can find us on Facebook. Just simply search for Your Weekend Show. You can even make it one word and send an email to bob@yourweekendshow.com. Until next week at this same time, may God richly bless you.
On the air and online at yourweekendshow.com with Bob Biermann.